Pradeep and Sanjeev are the our key functional experts on this. So technically and functionally, they are aware of EDCI. So I'll just hand it over to Pradeep. So he'll take it forward. Pradeep?
Yeah, Elza. Thanks, Elza. One minute. Hi, Gulraj. Yeah.
Hi, Pradeep. How are you? It's been a long time.
Yeah. yes. I'm just sharing my screen. Okay. So the today's plan is overall. We are going to refresh again by explaining the EDCI service, how we configure, and how to configure these DCR rules for a particular state, and what are the steps you need to follow, and how to set up locally just only for DCR part. These we're going to explain today actually. Compared to last time when we locally deployed, the logic is we are deployed the whole ERP stack actually, which covers including the application process part. We have a microservice version of Digit where we are going to use the only EDCR part, and we are scrutinizing all the drawings using, I think the echo. Sanjeev, can you mute? It's echoing. Okay. So now, using this Digit platform, what we did is it's an entire application flow we configured here, and the DCR part, we are just coding using the same old format actually, like the same structure. We created a separate branch as EDCR service where the entire code base is there. One minute, I'll share my screen, then it is easy to explain. See my screen?
Not yet, Pradeep. Yeah, now we can see.
So this is the open source code, what we shared actually. It's a EDCR service. If this contains only the DCR related things we recorded here, we'll go in detail actually what are the things we are going to discuss today.
Ravind is the one that you shared today to me, right?
Yeah, what I shared. And this is the one more code base where where client specific we can configure actually. So this is the client specific changes we can configure. We'll discuss more detail about this and how to use these things actually, the code base, how to set up this locally, how to execute all these things we'll check actually. So before I'll show you the microservice version of this is my JIT platform actually. We'll go through a glance actually how it works actually. So maybe a few are new team are there. So this is a login screen where a citizen can log in actually. Citizen RK. I'm showing in the Microsoft view actually. See, as I logged in, this is a stakeholder actually. He already logged into our system. We have some option here, like in case of building plan approval system. I can register myself as a technical architect. And once I register as a technical architect on approval, we'll get a ADCR scrutiny option for this particular user. It has a workflow. And it is similar to how we showed last time, right? It is a similar logic. Initially, we saying as a citizen, once he registers himself as a technical architect, all the other buttons will enable, like he can scrutinize all those things based on the role what he selected.
Yeah, yeah, we are very much comfortable with all these things.
Okay. Now, one minute, I'll just show. So I want to do a new plan scrutiny. Yeah.
Hi, Pradeep. Karishma this side. I just want to take 1 minute and request all of the states. We know Kulraj is from Meghalaya and Shillong, but the others, we would just want you to put up your names and email IDs on the chat. The NIOA representative, she's trying to get in, but she's unable to get in. You can put it on chat and then you guys can continue. We won't disturb you any further. Will that work for everyone?
Karishma, I'll take care of that as well. In case anybody couldn't send the email ID, I'll send it on their behalf as well.
All right, then you and Kanika coordinate.
Sure, we'll do that. We'll do that.
Please continue, Pradeep. Please. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. So, the concept here is as an end user, this is the microservice architecture. We are calling the service now internally. So what we're doing internally, what we are calling EDCR service internally, and it is just validating the rules as per the particular state, actually, whether it is as per the state, it is correct or not. We are just verifying here, actually. This is the report already we developed, actually. So, Gulraj, before that, I want to know, anybody has newcomers in this list, actually, so that they are in this application?
Actually, all of us who are here, we're there in Bangalore, so we are very much aware of all these steps and everything. I think except for Tripura, we will extend the help from our side to them. That will not be, we'll be able to complete things much faster. No?
Yeah, so we'll, I'll just brief it up, actually, in that case.
Yeah,
so that's why I'm just showing the flow, actually, what just I'm just uploaded. I'm just showing what's happening so that they will get an idea, actually. On submission of this, what happened now is it is now validated this entire the particular state rules, whether it is accepted or not, actually. And that's what it's showing this report, actually. So what we are doing here is, this is nothing is in the drawing, actually. I just uploaded this one of the drawing where multi-block is there and so it's a DXA format, which we are uploading, as you guys know. And this is the diagram. This is a diagram of the plan where they already marked all these layers, actually. And using this diagram, we'll come to that layer structure, everything. We are just validated whether it is accepted or not accepted. So I just added, I generated one application number. If it is successful, I got this DCR number. Otherwise, it won't generate this DCR number. And there are some declarations. We'll come to this. What is these declarations? How to configure these? All this kind of thing in the system. So next one is, it will give the overall idea about what is the content of this drawing. Like it contains the block one, block two. In that, the block one contains residential, 0, 1, 2, all these things. Block two contains only residential building of 68 meters. What is the overall covered area, carpet area, all these things are there. And there are something called common. When the rules come to picture, we divide it into two parts. One is the rules we are validating, some rules based on the overall picture. Like an overall plan where we are scrutinizing some rule. This is amazing. And the three are separate actually. So come to this example, these are the common rules, what we discussing. Distance between the block. If they have multiple block, this would be a minimum necessary that we had, right? This is the bylaw. And the bylaw, we taking this condition, what is what he provided and what is the status. So there are status. If all are accepted, then only I'll mark the entire distribution set as accepted. Otherwise, mark it as not accepted. And there is a stages where states also call it as verify. Why we are saying verify is we are with a conditional approval, we are saying you need to verify this in the field. But also we are considering as an approval case. Example, I am saying I'm near to the CRZ zone or I'm near to the airport. He is just declaring. Maybe something is saying he's also declaring I'm not near to the airport, but we need to verify that. Is what he's saying is correct or not when I'm visiting the field inspection. So similarly, we check the floor area ratio. So these are all fields we give our own naming conventions. If you want, you can change these things in the reporting sections. So some places they call it as FSI, in some states they call it as floor area ratio. This also we can change actually. The green buildings, the multi-year validating, parapet we are validating, parking we are validating. There are so many rules we are validating. And then it will come to block wise. In each block, there are four sides we are looking, front, rear, side, and side one, side two. And based on the building, this combination, we are just validating these rules also. Okay, so there is a, so these are all specific to a particular block, whatever validations required, we are just validating here. So there is a general stage, the height of the building, number of floors, the paint area, the staircase. Similarly, same thing we are checking for the block two also. So it's in the system, the intelligence is, so it will automatically pick and choose. It's not fixed for each diagram what I'm submitting. It will vary based on the type of the diagram what I selected, what the contents what I have, example, based on the area. If it is more than 200 meters, I can mark solar as mandatory. So I'll check only if solar is mandatory based on some condition. So otherwise, what happens, we'll throw that particular error here directly saying that you're not declared these the layers also, those kind of also we are validating and we are throwing in error. And we are not accepting the rule. So once this everything is correct, actually, what architect do is, he can do, the advantage of the system is he can scope multiple times. And based on the final version, if he feels, okay, this is the final version, I can make use of this for the next level of application process, he will just use this application. He will add this as a, in the application submission. So currently we have two options. One is occupancy certificate and permit. These are the two services we enable. I'm just entering.
Pradeep, 1 second. We have only 2 hours, okay? So if we have to get into the code and configuration, okay. Just rush through this. These things, they are already aware, I guess.
Not going in detail. I'm just trying to show only one more step here. No option available. Okay. So when I entered automatically from the drawing, it auto-populate all the plot areas, the kata numbers, whatever I added there. And similarly, in the subsequent place, it will show all the buildings also, it will auto-populating. And we are process further for the next process of the application flow. This is a wall of the document scrutiny and the application submission, actually. Now our aim is how to configure these rules in the system, actually. Like how we designed, what are the technologies required, how you need to deploy this locally, and how you are modifying your own state-specific roles, and what is the core system also required. There is something like, it is not necessary that each state has to modify, and deployment is being headed in that case. So we'll explain all those things. What's the overall architecture, what we planned actually. Okay. So any doubt in here?
No, we are fine. Very much fine with this.
Okay. So next step is, as Vulde is aware, what we did is we created some template format actually. So this template is a first stage in our system where we need to capture the each state-specific rules in our system. Before that, it's as a friendly what it is. It's not configurable through UI, all the rules. What we did is we just added this in a piece of code actually. It's in a class. Sanjeev will explain those things in more detail. We standard the CDC service, how we configurable, all those kind of things he will explain. But before that, when I am starting the code actually, as a first part, we prefer our rules are very important to be in some standard structure so that user can just, as a developer can just refer the sheet and he will just modify, he just code it actually. Coding is a big task as per our experience. It won't take more than 15 days per state based on the number of rule features. Example, in this case, example, I have these many features. It's already provided in the system. Okay. The for coverage, setback, distance, parking, mean of access, everything. Balcony, overhanging, kitchen. So we just added these are the high level. What are the things is required, the features in the system. As a particular state, we can decide what I can switch on, what I want, I can pick from this particular list actually. Example, maybe the compound one is not, may not require valid for a particular state. I don't want this, I can skip it actually. But these are the features which is already present. So that we need to customize based on requirement of the state. Similarly, we also listed a list of occupancies which are coming under a different stages actually. Okay, so we just grouped it actually. When I'm saying there are occupancy and sub-occupancy concept, we just grouping all the occupancies and sub-occupancies individually. How we are doing example in the residential, all residential apartments, this is a special residential cases, hostel with residential building, the farmhouses, these are all we clubbed under residential. And there is something called usages also. Why it is required usages, we'll come to that actually. The reason here is the usages required based on your building bylaws. There are some use cases like you have a zonal concept. When zone comes into picture, you are saying under a particular occupancy, I don't want to enable some set of activities in the building in that particular area. So those cases, what we are doing is we are just filtering those things based on this usage list actually. Example, I have a permission to construct a commercial building, which is of type commercial occupancy, but I'm not allowing to just only electrical shops are allowed, not mechanical shops are allowed. So how to restrict? I'm just giving an example. So this configuration, it's easy by dividing all these things actually. The second one is, this way, we just selected and grouped all these things under a particular education. See, coaching center we added, but we are not divided multiple times into coaching center for primary school, high school. We are not added like that. Why we did like that? Because there are some rules are defined in the rule book for the coaching centers. When you're selecting a coaching center, then there is some set of rules are applicable in the rule book. Okay. And similarly, when you're selecting physical education centers, the particular state has their own set of rules for the physical education and schools also. And whenever I am marking, these are all the occupancies, we are just giving a color coding for this. Because how to identify this, whether what he marking is a college or a play school or a nursery school, the system will understand only with some set of standard color coding. So this is a template kind of thing we need to prepare. And we are just marking, we are giving a unique number for each type of these occupancies and sub occupancies. With this way, so similarly, we just listed the few things. It depends on the state. We just need to give a standard color coding, and we just segregated this. So there may question arises now, whether is it necessary that we need to use the same color coding across different states? Because as I see here, the NSA has different states. May not require. So these are all configurable at a database level, so that if you want, you can modify it easily, the color codings. The color coding, I can use residential one, may not require in other state. I can use two also. This is configurable at the database level, so that the color coding also, you can change at any time, actually. One. And the sub-occupancy also. I can keep on adding new sub-occupancies if required in the system. So what's the plan is, example, take floor area ratio. It will may confuse. Okay, we'll come up with a simple use case. We just extracted like this. What we said, it's a, as per the bylaws, for all the occupancies, the coverage should be this much. This is mandatory. And these are the different types of occupancies. What is the coverage is defined in the your building bylaws, we are defining. Okay. So we just copied this actually, this format, and we just marked all these things in this particular to coverage. So what we are trying to do here is, if for a particular feature, for all the occupancies, whatever validations required, is it mandatory, all these kind of things, we are just adding in a one standard format. I'm not saying that this may be in any format, okay? This is just to help the developer to code your things. It is not necessary that it should follow the same format or anything, no. So some highlight is required. Example, in some states, you are using the road width to define the road width you are using for some calculation. It may not be on the other state. Other state may using maybe the area wise I'm just calculating. Those things we need to highlight in the sheet so that the developer, once he is coming to this sheet, when he is developing the setback, he'll just refer this. And he will say, okay, the setback, these are the conditions, minimum setback, all those kind of things, he is keep on adding. So you see, in this case, educational building, it's very straightforward. The front rear side is, these are the minimum meters it's required. We're just using this for coding. In case of industrial, if the area is within less than 50 and plot width is less than 10, these are the values. So we organize this. This is very, very important to convert this in the initial stage, and we need to go through all the rule book. The rule book, sometime in some section, like floor area ratio, what they define in one section, it may be contradictory in other section, when it depends on some use cases. So those things we need to cover everything, and we need to put it in a, it's a kind of bucket. We are just adding all the FAR related, setback related in one place, right? So this exercise will help us in avoiding all the future errors, all the use cases which are missing in the system actually. So take example of floor area ratio we define, but still there are some exclusions are there. We just added everything here. There are some use cases they are saying, if we have a mezzanine floor, don't consider it as for the floor area ratio. If you are under the whatever the area below the ground floor, it might be cellar, don't consider it for the floor area ratio. These are the different use cases comes when you're reading the rule book. Those things you just keep adding in one place, and later when you're coding, you just go one by one and you keep marking somewhere that, okay, all these things are covered actually. And it will helpful for you to add your own use cases, test cases in coding also, so that in future, if you change anything, we can just running the test cases only, we will get to know whether it's breaking anywhere else or not. Okay. So this is the template format. I'm just so this is a rainwater harvesting. Whatever rule says, we try to add here, and we are going to code this use case. Okay, this is a template. This is the first stage where we need to capture all the rules related things, and we'll go further for next stage. Sanjeev? You want to add something?
I can take over.
You want to take over?
Yeah, please.
Hello
guys, Sanjeev here. So from the technical side, I share my screen.
1 minute, I'll stop my screen. Okay.
My screen visible?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, from the technical side, the main prerequisites which we require is basic Java, and how do we see the DXF file and the basic math. So, like starting, how do we start? We have actually two APIs. One is to scrutinize the plan, and one is to fetch the plan. There's an extra API to extract only the plan data. So when we compare the report output, this is to show how we map the data with the DXF file. So this is, as you can see, this is the application details. This is generated through code. The plot details, these are the declarations. Declarations are those values which can only be a text in the DXF file. So these declarations, the plot number, MOSA, road width area, and the NOC declarations, we tell the architect to declare in the plan info layer. Plan info layer, as you can see, it's only an mtext layer. It's an mtext. So here we declare all the plot number, kata number, MOSA. So all the text which can be declared in the DXF file are declared in the plan info layer. So this is for the plan info layer. We get all this.
Sanjeev, we can't see your screen, I think. Can you?
Is Meghalaya disconnected?
I'll reconnect. Is it visible?
Yes, Sanjeev.
Okay. So we can see these declarations and the plot details as a text in the DXF file in this plan info layer. So it is an mtext. It contains all the declarations. So what the extract engine does is it picks up this data and it sets to the plan object. That this, the plot detail and declarations are from the plan info, and when we come to this built up area, so
Sanjeev, can you just copy the content and can you expose it, the content of that plan info?
Okay.
Just to add one point, Goldrace, if we are not going in the right track, just let us know. This is not what you really want to understand. It's something else. Just speak up.
Okay.
Goldrace just joined, I think.
Yeah, Goldrace, I was just checking whether we are in the right flow. These are the things which you'd like to clarify or something else. Goldrace, can you hear? okay, continue.
Oh, Sanjay, we continue.
So as you can see, this plot number, kata number, moza, plot area average width, these are all declared by the architect in the plan info. So our extract engine it extracts the data, and in the report output we are representing all the data in the required format. So when we come to this occupancy and suboccupancy, in the plan, there with the layer name, which is block and floor level wise. So we have three types of declaration. One is the block level, the floor level, and the plan level. Plan level declarations are those which are specific to the whole plot. Block are specific to a particular block, and floor is for a particular floor. So as occupancy is declared in floor wise, we can see the naming convention in the block underscore one floor and the floor number with the built up area naming convention.
Yeah, guys, the overall plan is we are doing it based on layer names or color coding standard. These are two things, main things to understand. The third one is a plan info. What is the content of the plan info? With the three values, we are adding all the functionalities into the system actually. So as he's suggesting, the layer names are also very particularly we designed. If it is generic, we are not adding any block number. If it is only within a block, what are the examples of in a block? Only block number I can use. Example, I want to define only the setback area of a particular block. So it is not floor wise, it's a block wise. But if I want to mention a floor wise area, I'm defining by mentioning the floor also. Possibility that in a one floor, I have parties in different occupancy, another party is in different occupancy. I am marking that with a color coding so that that's how the system will understand what is the each number of floors and what are the different occupancies they define in each particular layer or in a particular floor. Go ahead, Vinu. Sanjay.
Okay. So the occupancy we define as the color code. We have two tables as occupancy and suboccupancy. As you can see, the occupancy, we have different occupancy data here, and each occupancy can have a color code here. So similarly for suboccupancy, we are mapping the code and the to which occupancy does the suboccupancy belong and the color code for that particular suboccupancy. So when we look into the drawing, we can see the the occupancy is only considered if the polyline taking the polyline in the built up area. So this is the built up area layer. When I check the color, it is 153, 95 and 76. This is the RGB color. So this is equivalent to the color 25 of the AutoCAD color index. So as it is declared in this particular RGB color, as it is declared in the 25 and the mapping is also for residential. This is 25. Mapping is for residential. We get the occupancy as residential. So all the color code which we need to define for a particular occupancy or suboccupancy, we can define it in this particular tables. So coming to the different levels, so we can see only the plot level layers. This is the parking is shown in the floor level. So it is in block and floor. We can see the height, building height. It is only defined with a particular block. So as Pradeep already mentioned, these are all plot level, common or nothing but plot level. So in the code, what we do is, if it is a plot level, if it is a plot level scrutiny, then we append it with a common underscore. So the in the report output, what in the report output, if it is declared as common underscore, the report output is generated as the common here in the common table. Similarly, if it is for a floor level, we declare with the block underscore, but we have an extra column as floor. So if we see the stairs here, it is in block level, it is having floor. Similarly, if it is only for block, it is only for block, we don't have a floor column here. We have the other columns which is required for the particular role.
Sanjeev, can you just go after what Gundresh has requested?
Okay.
Just see the chat. He has put the list of things he would like to see.
Okay. Okay. So I've for the time to save time, I've already cloned the two GitHub repositories. That is the EDCI service part and the client part. So these are the EDCI service part. And the other three are for the client. So for the configuration, there is actually no change in the configuration in the code level. As I can show you, these are all generated from the Eclipse. So there's no change in any other files. So only what we have to do is we can set up a server directly after cloning. So we are using Wildfly 11. So this is the main EDCR build. I'll add it to the server. So here I'm pointing the server. So before starting the server, we can see the data in the EGCT table. So in the EGCT table, the domain URL is ulb.egovernment.org. The same thing, you can find it in the application properties. Here, ulb. So this is the schema and this is the domain URL. So similarly, we have a state city table in the state schema. So here in the state schema, we can see it is state.egovernment.org. So the same state.egovernment.org is there with the state schema. So before we start, for to use this URL in the root folder, we have an etc file folder. So this etc folder has a file called host. Here we have to map this particular domain with the local IP.
See, for a local developer, he's explaining how to set up locally. You can use this URL directly, ulb.egovernment.org, or you can use directly localhost also.
So after adding it to the
Pradeep.
Yeah, Kuldres.
Yeah, Can we do one? Can you help us with one thing? Okay. Like I've said earlier, based on the earlier questions, we will be able to receive everything fine. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Can we go right from the very beginning? Number one, can you just list? I think everyone has shared the list today for us, right? Everyone has shared the list of all the facilities for us, right?
Yeah, Gurudev, your voice is not clear.
Sanjeev, can you go on mute for a second?
Yeah.
Yeah, Gurudev.
Yeah. Elvin, you have shared the list of all the JIT URLs today, right?
So basically, today I have sent the Digit 2.0 release note. You're talking about
right.
that.
Right.
Yeah. For that. Yeah.
So So I can see a lot of repositories. We have one is the front end, one is the core services. And we have business services, municipal services, utility services, and other services, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Right. So we need to clone all these URL into one folder, right? Into one directory of ours, right?
Yeah. So Pradeep, you can run through that. Like what all will be required only for OBPS, you need to first tell.
I think that if we can just know which particular repository should we start to work on it, that'll be much better, right?
Yeah. Right. Gunraj will share that actually. That is how to application sure, part, how to configure, that is one. Sure. In this session, we are discussing about EDCR and how to configure that locally, how to develop that for a particular state.
Okay.
And how to use that in the application part is a different. It's what we have a EDCR services. We have 2-3 services we are exposed. So we are just calling those APIs directly to EDCR service. And we are just getting their response based on state specific actually. To configure that, how to individual state wise, what the configuration required, how developer need to set up locally, that's what Sanjeev is explaining now. Any confusion or it's you want me to?
Yeah, so Gulres, if you see in that list, EDCR service is one service of all the Digit 2.0. So that one particular EDCR service is the heart of your application. So that one specifically is what Sanjeev is explaining you. Maybe we can show how to configure that one service locally and how to edit and how to deploy. That's what we intended to do in this workshop.
That'll be good.
Yeah.
So please. Pradeep, Sanjeev, we are aligned, right?
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. So after mapping it, after mapping both the URLs for the local IP, we can directly start. So only change we do is we clone the repository, we add a server. In the host file, we map the URL with the local IP. So that is the only change that we have to add. So I'm cleaning the server, I'm starting it.
Sanjeev, before that, just 1 minute, I'll explain the DCF service. Sure. Maybe they will get more idea about how we are processing everything.
Okay.
Or you'll explain the code and then we'll show.
Yeah, I'll finish the code part.
Okay, continue.
So actually we have two APIs, as we mentioned. One is to scrutinize the plan. Another one is to fetch the scrutinized plan. This is nothing but the search API. The scrutinized plan has a request. So in the request, what we actually send is we have a transaction number. Application subtype is nothing but the service type. Is it for new construction, altered or addition of construction? And the application type, whether it is for TCR or this is for the plan permit or other one is for the occupancy certificate. So for the occupancy certificate, the difference is in occupancy certificate, we pass it as OC plan scrutiny. Here we in the plan permit, we pass it as only the plan scrutiny. So coming to the coding part, So this is the scrutinized plan API. Here we have a few mandatory fields. So we are validating mandatory of application type and the service type. That is these two. So only if those two are present, we'll go through the process. So depending on whether it is OC plan scrutiny or plan scrutiny, we generate the OCDCR number or the EDCR number. So this is where we build all the EDCR object. This is all the building of the EDCR object. So before we process, we save the application here. So the basic state of the application will be as aborted. After the process is done, the status will change to either accepted or not accepted. So after saving, we are going for the DCR process part where we process the file. So here we have the, so when we see this flow diagram, we hit the controller. From the controller, it comes to the plan service. Here in the plan service, it is actually segregated into three: extract, process, and generating the report. So this extract part is a separate extract engine. Process part is what we can override here. So this is the extract part. Apply rules is the process part. So this extract part, what it does is it picks up all the data depending on the layers. It creates the plan object. It sets all the data in this and it gives it here so that we can apply all the rules on this particular object. So after this process is done, process, what we do is all the FARs, all these rules get processed. After processing, we generate the report. So this generation of report will yield in creating this this particular report. So to take a small example,
Sanjeev.
Yes, sir.
Can you open the DCR? One more tab you have. DCR survey. DCR as a service. Yeah, one more. Not this. Yeah.
This one, right?
So Gulday's question is how to clone this is one question. How to run the application from local machine is another question.
Yeah.
And he wants one parameter from the DCR template and he wants to change in the code. Sure. And he wants to see how it reflects and how we are running actually. You want to see these three parameters. That's his main intention.
Okay. Pratib, remember we had work on a file called far_climb.java?
Same. We'll get to that actually. Okay. I got your point. Just mute one
more. Far.java and far_climb.java?
Okay. There are two things. One point is what we did is it's a time to answer your question. DCR as a service, what we did, right? This is like a core actually. That Sanjeev, we can open the code also. EDCR as a service in Git also. When we imported that, what we are doing here is this is the default functionality. You can let's on that they call also NIC. We said there is one centralized code which contains all the default logic. Example, in our process, what we are doing is we are dividing into three parts. One is extraction part is different, the process part is different, reporting is different. These are the three stages. Now, here, these are the features, what he's showing, like accessory building, balcony, all these things. So individually, we are just adding all this as, example, far is also there. We added all this as one of the feature list. It is there in one central place. This is there in the EDCR service. Let's think, you want to move this code to Meghalaya now. So There are two ways. One is directly you can modify the for changes directly in the file what is showing here. If you do this, it will not become any state specific. Okay, it depends on the deployment also. If you consider the centralized code is for the state specific, then it is possible. Like you can modify directly the entire repo in one place and you can release it for the entire state. But problem is, if you want to implement for multiple clients, then these changes may not work over the other client. So this is the centralized code, which will be handled by the state, some team. Okay? These are all the basic things like extraction, several things. By default, you're already adding a comma things here. If any, what we suggest is we have a different branch. Sanjeev, we just open in nine files actually. You just need to create a particular branch for each of your client. If you have a Meghalai, you create it as this Meghalai actually. This is for Meghalai. This is for Assam. Like that, you are creating a multi. Can you go to Git actually? Just open this in the Git actually. Client specific code. Yeah. The master actually here. Master is just a, okay. You just explain how to use this master code for a particular client. Just go. You have any branches here, master? This is one branch created. Similar to that, what you can do is from this repo, you can create a separate branches for each client specific. Okay. Sanjeev, we have any files here, the announcements? In this branch, you have any files? Yeah, in the announcements only. Go now. Okay, so the logic what we are using is each state level. That's why we divided into a state and the city actually. The schema structure is, can you go outside, Sanjeev? In one database, you have one state schema and each city what you are adding it as a multiple schemas actually in the city. Come down. See here, the state is at the state level. Okay, and individual city, example here, inside that Gangtok, all these things, if you want, you are creating a new cities inside as a one schema actually. So all the Gangtok related things are in one place and all the individual cities are in a concerned particular schemas actually. This is the structure of the database level. So similarly, when you're coding also, you're just appending that client name actually. The last time what we did is far underscore client. Instead of that, you can say far underscore Meghalaya, far underscore Assam, like that. So it will become state specific. You are keep on adding. And when you're running it, automatically pick the Assam or Meghalaya based on the combination actually. But we prefer it will be each state specific if you are deploying independently. Then also what you are doing is you are copying the EDCR service one common Git plus the implementation of the concerned state you will combine together and you will run in a one container. That's the plan. Good, is any confusion here?
No, we're good. Please carry on.
Okay. The point here is there is a default code plus you are adding the Meghalai, then it will become Meghalai related changes in one particular container and you are running that. Similarly, you are just copying the content of the individual state and combining with the main object, main our Git repo of EDCR service, we are deploying. That's the plan. Now, in an individual state, how they need to follow some structure is that's what he's showing here. Example, here, headroom. Headroom we added, it's a Bangalore. Instead of Bangalore, it should be becoming Meghalaya or Assam. The naming we are adding like that. So how it will pick is state level, we have something called code in a EGCT table. There, if you mention it is a Meghalaya, it will look for all the files which are extended with far underscore Meghalaya, headroom underscore Meghalaya, like that. And it will pick that particular file at the runtime. Okay, so this will change it based on, that's why this whatever you are looking, right, client implementation, this contains only state specific changes in this. The bottom one, whatever is showing in this Eclipse, all are common across all the state. That's how it is designed. Okay. So here, this is the headroom is a default implementation what we provided. Now he is going to modify that in that particular state. It's like Bengal or whatever, Bangalore. This is specific to that particular one. It will pick actually. Also, in the same way, we can support for district-wise changes also. Let's think you have some particular district-wise, you have some changes. So we coded in such a way that it will pick from first state. Sorry, there is some order we added. A particular city it will look first. If city, how it will get the city is, as I suggested, Gangtok is one of the schema. We know what is the code of that particular city. It should be unique actually in a particular state schemas, okay? For that city, whether you have any rule, it will check first. If it is not there, it will look at the district level code. If it is not there, it will look at the state level code. And it will pick the concerned rule and it will scrutinize this. See, this is the AGCT table. That's what he's showing. There is a city specific code is there. District level code is there. We added. And as a state level, we have a particular code. Based on these three values, we are deciding what are the rules I need to pick for each particular city actually. So that's how we planned actually. You just need to clone the concerned client IMPL with a particular state. You create your own repo by creating a branches and you start coding like this. Example here. So you know that what are the features you want to modify, you just add it actually. That's it. So, and you process it actually. Otherwise, by default, rules will applicable to those states also. So how to run? So there is no UI now actually. The previously, the plan is you're deploying the entire application actually. With the old format of application flow, all those things. So we are logging in everything. Now it is straightforward. What we are doing is we are using the Postman scripts. We know this is we exposed already 2-3 APIs where I can push the data and I will get the data also. So using these APIs in the Postman, your servers are running like this. It's already running. You are just calling the concerned URL by specifying what is the tenant ID. The tenant ID is very important. You are specifying, you are running this for a particular city. So example, when you're running for Gangtok, you're specifying it's for Gangtok. So internally, it will, that record will save in the Gangtok. So internally, it will look what is the state of the Gangtok and any Gangtok specific rules are there, it will execute. Otherwise, it will execute at the state level rules directly. And you'll get the output directly as in a response actually. In the response, if you have it, either maybe show it's a success or failure. If it is success also, it will show you the file store URL actually that you are using and you are taking the output and you can see whether all the rules are correct or not. So in this output, we'll see the what is the planned report actually. This is the URL you just copy it and paste in your tab. It will show, okay, what is the output of the URL. So there is no need of any login, any UI, nothing is required here. So maybe login related some credentials required that you will specify how to run locally. Otherwise, this is what required. If you want to change one of the parameter, we'll change and we'll show you how to do that.
Pradeep, what is the hierarchy? You said state, city, state, district, city.
It's a reverse actually. First, we are looking for the city actually.
Okay.
If it is not there, we are also looking for some ULB grade also. Something is there. There are chances are like I can configure based on ULB grade also. And if it is not there, we are looking at the district level. If it is not there, we are looking at the state level. So this is just required because there are chances like in corporations, they have their own set of rules. They may say, I don't want setback in some of the state. Or maybe in a particular, they can't say like that. Maybe they can reduce or they can increase. They have some specific rules for a particular city. You can configure that also. But only main concern is the city code, what you are using, it should be unique in per state and it should be predefined and it should not be modifiable actually. Once you define, we need to use the same thing. Otherwise, the meaning will be different actually. Okay, so there is no UI required now. Use a Postman, run your server locally, you do coding everything and you run it actually. So there are two things here in the Eclipse he showed actually. One is BPA service, also client implementation also is adding locally, but some minor changes required how to deploy client jar also locally, so that you're just modifying in the client. If Meghalaya team is there, they're just modifying the code of the Meghalaya only. So they are just touching the client implementation part of only. They should not touch the remaining thing, because the remaining whatever EDCR service is there, the control should be with the state team, so that they should not modify anything at the state level. Guzan, it's clear or any?
Just repeat the last line again, Pradeep.
So, there are two branches I showed. One is EDCR service. EDCR service will be in the control of the state team, so that they can add any functionalities required for a particular state or those kind of things. Example, I want one more extra feature now, like I want MUMPTY calculation as a form, one more. That those kind of common things required, they will add at the state level with the EDCR service. This will be in a control with all the state thing. This code is just referred as a part of a developer at the Eclipse level, but implementation only they will modify by the client, particular state team.
Yeah, this headroom, this is in the state level. So we can see it is a 2.2 which is required. So what we are doing in the state, say for a Bangalore city, I need it to be a 3. What we do is we extend the file to the main state level headroom and we give a naming convention of underscore the name of the city or the district.
It may be a district or a city, whatever I want, we'll add if I.
If it is city, it is only the city name. If it is district, then we have to provide it as underscore district.
It's a code actually we are using. District code.
So whatever we want to override, we can override. So here it is a minor change. Instead of 2.2, here we have changed it to a 3 value.
Can we run this locally, Sanjay?
Yeah, one. I'll show it.
Just run for a particular state first.
This is for the state.
Okay.
One. So we can see this is in the state, so it is a value is 2.2. So now I'll run for the client now. So I have added the file.
Sanjeev, we are running two separate Eclipse, one for client, one for service.
this is in the same. We can do it as separate also.
It's in same, right?
Yeah, it is in same.
Pradeep, the client part will be the same that we had used earlier, right? In Bangalore? Same repository?
Same.
The client part. The client part.
Client path is same. Service we modified actually.
Oh,
the service EDCA service is previously to BPA actually. DJ BPA. We moved it as a DCR service now.
So I'm running it for the client now.
Sanjeev, so just show what you're changing actually. 1 minute. Yeah. What you changed?
So for the state, the value is actually 2.2. So for the client, I've changed it to a 3.
Okay. Now, in the when you're calling that REST actually, you are passing some other code, right? Client.
Only the transaction number I've changed.
What about client ID?
Client ID can be different.
Yeah, you just modified that.
I am using the same client.
Okay. To pass, right? The consent code.
Pass.
Check in your database. What is the city code? Is it Bangalore?
It is Bangalore, yeah.
Can you check?
It is Bangalore. The name, it picks up the name actually.
To modify that, I think. Check once.
Correct. One. I clean the server. Give me a.
No, when you're passing that postman screen, you're just also passing this one. What is that? The tenant ID.
Correct.
No, pass it.
It is in ULB level. I am using the tenant ID as 002. The code.
You're passing 002?
Correct.
Okay. You added this client IMPL in this project? You're not deployed, I think.
It is deployed. 1 minute. It is a client IMPL.
Okay.
Oh, it is reflecting 3.
Yeah. So in the state, in the city specific, we mentioned it is 3, so it is picking the city file first.
Because it can get this file first, it is processing this file instead of the state level.
Gulres?
Yeah. Suraj has some questions.
Yeah, please.
The thing that I wanted to understand is this EDCR, the service, as well as this client implementation, both are as a REST web service, right? Yeah. So, okay. Earlier, when we were in the Bangalore, we had the UI part also in the same, same package, right?
Sanjeev, can you mute?
Yeah, on that.
Okay, I didn't get you, sir. UI also?
No. I'm pretty confused right now. Right now what we are doing is we are working on the DCR configuration, right?
Correct.
We are working on 2 repo, right? So, the client implementation, so which would be specific to a district or, ULBs. Which we would be modifying. These two, the scrutiny part are being exposed as a web service.
Okay. Okay. So web service. So the plan is, as I showed you the first screen, the plan is there is an application. Forget it, whether we are using our application or it is any third-party application. Okay. NIC also, they have this requirement. They said, we already have a system. I just want to integrate your system.
Yeah, like the case of Assam.
Assam. Okay. The plan here is, you're just using the DCR service, which is a, let's think I'm just implementing for a one state. Don't worry about, don't mix multiple state things and combine in one rule. It won't work out. It will work, but it won't look correct actually. Easy option is, every state specific, I'll create a DCR service is one of the core. And implementation as a separate, we just added. Advantage here is, let's say if tomorrow you are adding some functionality which is required for all the states, you can just modify in one of the centralized places DCR service. Clear?
Yeah.
Only it won't break anything with the implementation partner, because the implementation they are just using and they are modifying what they want. Second point, come to your point. I don't want UI in this case. We are just published 2-3 REST APIs where I just need which state or which tenant. How we are processing different cases. What we need some information where I'm marking, this is my tenant. For this tenant, I want to scrutinize my rule. Anyway, the URL is matters. If I'm saying it's a Meghalaya, I'm using the Meghalaya URL. I'm passing the particular city code. Saying that for a particular city, you just scrutinize and give me the output. So we are talking, we using the REST APIs, and by passing the basic information of the city information based on the drawing, I'll scrutinize it. It's left to the user.
Are we passing the drawing as well here?
Yes, in the, when you're uploading the DXF.
Yeah.
Okay, Sanjeev, we'll show everything. We'll go slowly.
Yes.
Okay, here we are adding some header parameters where we are passing something, as well as we are also passing a particular drawing also. This is the drawing he's uploaded, multiblock.dxf in the postman. Yes. So this you can change it into Assam also in the URL, so that it will push the same diagram to Assam. You can validate.
Can you just share this?
Postman script will share.
Yeah.
We'll share, okay? So DXF also there as a part of this REST, you are just pushing this actually. So this satisfy your requirement of individually calling without any existing system also. Right? So we just need a DCR service you can utilize like this.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, this is...
Hello? Address.
It's it's understood. It's very much clear now, Pradeep.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. I'll just have one more question. So the UI part, there has not been any change from the one that we had downloaded since January, right? I think
No, actually, it will changes are there because January, what we shared initially.
Sorry. Has shared it to me about 2 weeks back.
Uh-huh. 2 weeks back, what we shared. That's what I showed you a demo in the first screen, right? Like I log in as microservice, I push one record, right? That is a new UI for citizen to log in and architect to log in. And they are internally calling this REST API to get the response and request. That's how it is planned.
Okay, fine.
Okay, it's just an integration part. Integration part, in that application, we are just calling these URLs based on the tenant, all those things actually. Yeah, any other questions? One more thing. Guntas, what we did, one more thing is this Elasticsearch we disabled now. We made it configurable. If you don't want to push to Elasticsearch also, we just add a flag called Elasticsearch is disabled. So if you don't have Elasticsearch...
Elasticsearch as of now. Because there have been some reservations from the project group. I think some security features were there, and they have, they mentioned something about Elasticsearch.
Fine.
I think enable Elasticsearch for now.
Use this flag actually, Elasticsearch.enable.
In the configuration file, na?
Correct. If you just enable it, no need to run your Elasticsearch also locally now. Oh, just what you need is just this Wildfly and this Java code and one backend database for a developer to check.
Four.
Two, sir.
No, those other four are supporting projects. Kaam to sir do nahi karna. Kaam to sir do nahi.
Sanjeev, can you open the DCR part where the architecture flow is there, right? We can explain them actually, the DCR. Not this, another one, DDCR. Sorry, the previous one only, in the bottom. Go down. Something, there's one DXF file is there, right? Now go up. 1 minute, I'll just ping you. There's something called development control roles, digit DCR. Just I'll ping you, wait.
This is a...
Wait, I'm just pinging you.
It is the same.
Same, huh? Come down this, yeah.
This is the layer name.
There's one more diagram is there above the sequence diagram. It's not showing here.
No,
go up. Above this, go a little bit up. Yeah, here. Wait. It's not showing here.
No.
Come down. No, before, below the Java. Here, that image.
It is not showing.
You logged in as e-government user?
Yeah, as e-government user. It's in my profile.
Okay. Okay, that's fine. Okay. Guntas, any other either doubts or any more clarification required? Any questions?
Yeah, we are good, Pradeep. Please carry on.
Sanjeev, just locally, how to deploy that? You can show it. If any more you want to share in the local setup?
No changes, Pradeep. Only we have to add the Wildfly server. Okay. Only add this, map the URL with the local host.
Mm-hmm.
Start the server. There's no other changes required.
Okay.
Because you can see even the Git stages, there's no changes here. It's like,
Pradeep, anything on the domain we need to explain, like the tenant ID thing?
No, that's fine. That's fine, Elzen. That's fine. The domain
okay.
is not a problem.
Okay.
That's
domain
in
the area. Guldraj, only my concern is like when you're deploying, try to deploy state specific actually. Try to make, because EDCR service, what you're defining. Sanjeev, can you open the file where we are configuring what are the features to be run? A repository file. See, this is a file where we are configuring, saying that you need to run in this order actually. Send you mute. Okay, so here, this is a file where we are configuring, saying that for a particular state, you go in this order actually. When we are running, right, the for, coverage, setback, there are some basic things that should be in the top actually. This order is also matter, because in the floor area ratio, we are setting all the drawing contents, the floor areas, occupancies, everything comes into picture. And in the same way, we are keep on adding new functionality to this. Come down, monument, roof tank, everything. See, if you don't want something, you can remove those functionalities from here, saying that, okay, I don't want this to run. Just comment it. So this entire section of this, it won't execute for your particular state actually. So this control will be at the centralized place if you don't want to scrutinize anything instead of this particular use case. Okay, even though they have a particular code, it won't work out because this is the place where we configured that just execute this road width, plot area, those kind of things actually. Second one, this should be at the state level control actually. And DCR part inserted. Similarly, report output also. The report output we can modify as per your requirement. If it is any state specific changes you want, you can override that and you just modify it actually. So if you maintain it is this entire set is for each state, it is good. Even in database structure also, what happens is you have one database for entire state. And under that, for each city which are went live, we have that list actually. And the concerned tenant will be there in the concerned Wildfly actually. This is how the structure is. But if you are combining both Assam and Meghalaya together, and if you deploy, the structure will be in such a way that one database which contains the set of both states together, it won't work. So it's better to maintain separate state specific in one group. That's how it is designed. Any confusion here, Gulzar? It's very, very important. Otherwise, tomorrow you will come and say it won't support multiple state together, actually. The deployment also should be in that way we need to plan, actually. So what we are doing, one more thing is we are containerizing this. The advantage is this entire client implementation code is there, right? We are grouping it and we are running in a separate pod so that any changes when it is modified for a particular state, we are just using this particular service for a particular state actually. Okay. Guldraj, that's it from our end actually. If you have any questions, yeah. We'll answer it.
Thank you so much, Pradeep. Okay, Pradeep, we were working with Sikkim and we realized that okay, they have
you want to present something, you want to take any use case?
They need to have one extra parameter called a stability report. Okay, this okay. This is just a figure. This is a numeric value that is they go and apply for it from the Department of Mines and Geology, and mm-hmm. the government will just give them a report that the stability report is so and so. That's a numerical. Okay. I think we'll just have to put this into the AutoCAD diagram, right? As some parameter, correct. Right? Okay.
Yeah.
That is fine. The second part is that they need, there is in cases where the house is near to a road and there is a gradient, there's a slope in the plot. Mm-hmm. Okay. There's something called a gradient parameter that is required as well.
Okay.
Mm. Now the people from the Urban Affairs Department of Sikkim mentioned that this gradient can be extracted from the site plan.
Okay.
So can we incorporate that site plan here in this application, or shall we do it in, what do you advise?
Gulraj, one more I forgot to inform. See, for everything, we need a trained architect also should be involved actually, because whenever you are adding something, so we need to plan accordingly. It's a nice use case, you come up with a plan now. See, take one, first one. You said first one, what is that? Can you repeat the first question? What is the extra parameter you want?
Stability.
Yeah. See, stability is entirely a different, we are not scrutinizing anything related to stability. We're just looking at the building permit rules in the system. Second one, stability, just if they are mentioning some value in the system that we need to take and we need to validate, then it is good. So now tell me, in the system, I need to incorporate it into our system in a drawing. So I have three options. Where I can add this in a system. Is it possible to define a layer for this? Or any other options we provided in the system? How to incorporate it into our system now?
This is a fixed value, so to say.
Okay, correct. The fixed value where I can add actually in the system.
Yeah. I mean, if you remember, we did the overhead lines. Overhead transmission line, it can't be incorporated into the diagram, I think.
We can. Overhead electric line, we are adding, saying that this is the distance. We are auto-calculating the distance.
Oh, you're auto-calculating the distance. Fine.
He's mentioning the dimension. What is the dimension from the electric line? We are just reading that.
So in this case, I think we just have to let the architect push in this parameter, the value itself in the diagram.
Correct. So the where the placeholder in our case is, there is something called plan info. Okay. Sanjeev, can you open the plan info which you copied to desktop on that time? See, these are the plan info. Okay. So what we did, we added some set of default values here.
I'll just interrupt.
Go ahead. Please.
I think this will be something like the plot number, right? Plot number is something that the architect will put it down, he will write it down specifically.
Okay, not only that, we are missed here then in that case. So this is not only for that actually, it is nothing but a declaration what he is giving, whatever, anything in the system, I can add in this particular layer as a plan info. This is, the meaning is, he's saying, he's just example, you take building near to monument, he's just marking yes or no. If we are near to the monument, I have set up rules for that. Okay. But he is declaring, saying that I don't have any monuments near to my home. And based on that logic, we are validating and we are scrutinizing our rule book. And also we are marking this in the output also. We are clearly saying you declared there's no monument near to your house. And based on that, I scrutinize and this is your report. Similarly, when you are saying stability, that I can add it as one more parameter here as a part of plan info, and I'll take it as a whatever he declares, I can use that when I am processing my rule. I'll check if the stability is one and this is the area, I can say something whether it is successful or failure, or I can show the same thing in the output. The stability, what he declared is some value. It's also a problem. Hello.
Yes, Pradeep, please go ahead.
Yeah, whether it solves your problem actually, when if they mark it as in the plan info, saying that this is the stability is this much, and I'll use that in the when I am processing the plan, I'll check whether the stability is correct or not. And also I can show this as a, its stability is this much. That's what he declared. Voltage for Sikkim, whether it's it will solve this problem by adding that in the plan info.
I think so. I think so. It should be.
It should be, right? Similarly, I have one more question actually. You asked for one more that you want to check the plinth. What is that? Not plinth.
The gradient of the land.
Okay. See, how to mark is a question actually. Anything. Let's think I want to mark a solar panel in the system. I can mark it in a polyline. So there are different ways to define that in a drawing. One way is I can define a polygon saying that, okay, this is the location where I am adding the solar. Similarly, there are dimensions I can define in the system, like the distance to the electric line. I can mark it as a from my plot to electric line. This is the distance of the dimension I can mark. The advantage is I can measure it automatically instead of declaring. If we declare, he may say declare something, but when he's marking the exact distance from the electric line, I can measure and I can show this is what you marked in the system. So one way is polygon, one is dimension. Another is a declaration sections. Okay, so when your any new requirement comes, we need to think actually whether how to define this in the plan, whether we need to mark it as a polygon with a layer name, or can I accommodate that with using a different color code, and so that system will automatically understand that. So this stability, when you say it, right, something, so we need to think about it actually, whether by adding any polygons we can add in a site plan so that we'll measure it and we'll use it, or just by declaring that is also sufficient. Hello?
Yeah, Pradeep.
Yeah.
Then during that time, the gradient is not mentioned.
No, they have a site plan. They have a site plan, and then that site plan.
You can ask them to incorporate there as a polygon. No, but that's what he said, not as a dimension.
No, let's do one thing. We'll take the architects into consideration. We'll talk to the
Sikkim. How do you take care of
it? He has suggested that there's a site, we can take it from the site plan.
But site, how we'll know, how we'll draw that in the site plan is a question.
Right. It'll be like a total big project altogether again, just to get me.
Yeah, so that, see, my concern is when we are taking any decision, right? So architect also is required. See, example, compound one. I want to define the height of the compound one. How we'll draw that in the diagram is a question. Okay, so
how the architects are taking care of that?
They are taking care. They have a site plan. So now, but
then how do they put it on the site plan so that this can be? You have to come to some thing of
that. Yeah. Okay, Pradeep, my request to you is that if you can also have a thought from your end on this, we will also consult with the Sikkim team and see how it can be done. Maybe we can just embed the value itself like we did for the previous parameter, the stability parameter.
Correct. Gulraj, we can't move everything to plan info, as I suggested. If it is a kind of declarations, those kind of thing, definitely we can use it. I can take a declaration like I'm not near to lake, so that I can validate all the lake related, I can skip
for
that.
Exactly. Because right. Here we have one parameter which has not been officially notified in Sikkim, I'm talking. Near the Air Force Station. Remember he says. Okay, the Air Force, I am not so sure whether it's the Army or the Air Force, they have written to the department saying that all those plots which are located near the station must get NOC from them. Correct. They have obviously not notified. So it comes to the same thing like the lake issue that you mentioned just now. It is just a declaration. I'll keep on saying yes, but I'll violate it practically. Okay, we'll do that. I think the easiest thing will be to have it as a similar as the stability report just now.
Yeah, you please share the mail actually so that we'll give our feedback also. And it is better to involve the architects who really they need to talk with them how they are drawing the current system also.
So anything more, Gulriz, or are we done?
I will ask from this. I think most much. The cloud path. No, cloud path is taking care of something. Cloud path is being taken care of from the lead. Yeah, we should be ready with the cloud infra in a few days' time.
Yeah.
So meanwhile, we'll work on the groundwork and then we'll reach out to you if there's anything that's required from your end.
Yeah, but local development should continue. And should not.
We are continuing very much.
Okay. So if there's no more questions, we can wind up for the day. I can send this recording to you. You can share with your teammates.
Thank you so much, Elton. Thank you so much, Pradeep. And Sanjeev, thank you so much.
Thank you, Gulriz.
Thank you.
Thanks all for joining. Bye.
Bye, Gulriz.